Work with either of the NGOs, Abram Trust or CJP. But we are here because we have been for more than last two decades together in struggle for justice, particularly in the context of survivors of communal violence with Javed, Teesta and many others in this city. And so we are here basically because we feel our secular republic, Constitution of India, is somewhere under threat. Our democratic institutions are strained and the current executive dictatorial powers are trying to damage our republic and secular fabric of this country. So with this introduction, I just want to put forth few facts, after which the eminent speakers will present their viewpoints. Actually, we have distributed the information about the timeline regarding this case. Now, the specifics of this case have to be seen in the context of what is the struggle that has been fought by CJP, that is Citizen for Justice and Peace, and Sabram Trust. We also have to say that the entire case filed against Teesta and Javed has been based on concocted, fabricated allegations. And why it is so, that is what we have detailed out in terms of the finances of that institution, as well as giving the timeline of how the things developed. It should be noted that there have been almost five eminent authorities who have, over a period starting from 2001 onwards, every year have audited and looked at the accounts of CJP as well as Sabram Trust. Who are these five eminent authorities? It is Income Tax Department, it is Home Ministry, it is Charity Commissioner, it is two sets of auditor who have re-audited the accounts, and it is the donor agencies who have been giving donation to Sabram and CJP. None of these five authorities have ever found anything amiss for last 14 years. But now it is the Ahmedabad police who have stepped in to find some embezzlement, as they call it. And what is the context of this embezzlement? Somewhere post 2002 Gujarat carnage in Gulbarg society, Sabram Trust put forward a proposal in 2008 that they would buy all the premises of the Gulbarg society at market value and turn that into a museum of resistance. The Gulbarg society actually passed a resolution agreeing with this proposal put forth by Sabram Trust. After that, nearly for 3 years, that is from 2008 to 2011, Sabram Trust struggled to raise money for this effort. Even at the end of 3 years, that is 2011, they found hardly somewhere they could collect to the tune of 4.3 lakhs. That is the time they realized that they will not be able to take this task to completion. And they put forward to the Gulbarg Society that they are withdrawing their proposal. Gulbarg Society actually passed a resolution saying that now onwards all the members of the society are free to sell their property at market value. After this happened in somewhere around November 2012. Around this time there was also one disgruntled employee of Sabral Trust, Rais Khan, who had misbehaved with some survivors from Gulbarg Society, and his services had been terminated. This particular person, Rais Khan, since then have been in almost all cases appearing before all the criminal magistrates court and also putting forth a story that most of the witnesses are tutored by Sabran Trust or Teesta, and hence justice is not being delivered. In almost all the cases where he put forth this proposition, the judges did not take his claim on in account, and he was discredited. This same person was probably instigating some other people. So sometime in February 2014, the Ahmedabad police were given a false complaint, because it was on a forged letterhead of Gulbarg Society by one of the person residing in Gulbarg Society, saying that Sabran Trust has been accumulating money supposedly for the museum and is embezzling or misappropriating the donation which has been given. After this, police also wrote to society as well as to Teesta asking for explanation. Now society as well as Sabran Trust submitted to the police that this is a forgery, this is a false complaint. Police never thought it appropriate to take action against the person who had forged the letterhead or made the false complaint. But they decided to proceed against Sabran Trust, Teesta, Javed and two other persons, one of them being son of Mr. Ehsan Jafri, who was killed along with 69 others in Gulbarg Society. After they asked for the explanation and the explanation given, the accounts re-audited, the auditors gave all the accounts and all the required documents. For a considerable period, nothing happened. Something like 9 months, the police did not take any action. Then what happened is on 26 December 2013, the magistrate court in Gulbarg Society case gave a clean chit to Mr. Narendra Modi. And that is when the police started, got activated again. This was a case filed particularly for Gulbarg Society. This was the only case rather where the then Chief Minister of Gujarat, Narendra Modi, was personally implicated, and there was a case made that there should be a FIR filed against Narendra Modi and many other dignitaries of BJP and BHP. Now, after this particular clean chit which was given by the magistrate court, the police started again a re-investigation in this matter. And thereafter, they asked for many documents and accounts. Everything was submitted to them. The point is that actually the issue started with somewhere around 4.3 lakhs of rupees. But finally the police started asking about the entire history of the organization or the money and the accounts starting from 2001. All these were submitted. In fact, December and January, the only time that the police asked Javed and Teesta to come for explanation, both of them on two accounts appeared before Ahmedabad police, and gave them all the required information, all the documents that were there regarding the financial situation of the trust, both CJP and Sabrak. In spite of that, the matter continued and the anticipatory bail was rejected. During this period, one thing also needs to be noted, that without giving any intimation whatsoever, Gujarat police acted and freezed all the accounts of CJP and Sabrang Trust. Not only the accounts of these organizations, but even the personal accounts of Teesta and Javed were frozen. And they came to know directly from the bank, not from the police even. They came to know why it is frozen only when they approached the bank that Ahmedabad police had given the direction to freeze these accounts. Since then till now, the accounts are frozen. In every possible way, Javed and Teesta have cooperated with the police, submitted each and every document showing what is how the money was spent. They have submitted something around 15,000 vouchers giving details of the money spent. They have even made CDs of these vouchers and submitted to the police, appeared before the police, and still police are not satisfied. Still police want to take them in custody. One wonders why, given the record of the police in this country and the rate at which custodial tortures and death occurs in this country, we definitely fear that there is an ulterior motive behind it. Because if it was only to investigate the financial irregularities, they have all the documents before her. They have both the auditors also cooperating with the police. There is nothing more that needs to be revealed now. Because now within this we can just go over briefly and understand that Teesta and Javed worked almost 24 hours for this trust. Both of them, their survival comes from this trust. So they have been drawing regular salary from this trust as they are executing various projects. So what they have gained from this trust is only their salary, which every person who works is entitled to. Teesta comes from a well-to-do, wealthy family, and she has a bungalow in Juhu. But mind you, neither this bungalow or that property has come out of this work or either of the finances of this both these trust. The other point has to be noted is that many a times, particularly in India, most of the transactions, whether it is giving the bill of the chaiwala or a Xerox or a bus ticket or even a hotel booking in a small town, we have only cash transactions. There are no check transactions. So there have been a lot of cash transactions, but all of them are backed by the documents as to where the money has gone. Secondly, for various purposes, whether it is for buying tickets or booking halls or whatever it is, credit cards have been used both by Teesta and Javed. And wherever they have used money for trust, only that amount has been reimbursed to them. So what has been put out in press, that wine has been bought or branded clothes have been bought, they might have been bought, but that is not the money which has been reimbursed to both of them. So the money reimbursed to both of them on the credit cards also is only whatever was required for execution of various projects of Sabrang and CJP. And documents catering to that also have been submitted to the police and to the court, the lower level court as well as high court, and now these documents lie even with the Supreme Court. Now we can look at what the finances, because that's the crux of the matter. That is where the police are implicating that there is an embezzlement being done. So what needs to be noted is that today the entire accounts of Sabrang and CJP are out there in public domain. Right from 2001 to 2014, every penny that is spent and the project executed, the funders, who have given this money. Each and every of this information is out in public domain. There is nothing hidden. And in spite of that, if today Gujarat High Court also seems fit that Teesta and Javed have to be taken into police custody, one wonders what is more that they are going to find out after that interrogation. We are just showing you here a PowerPoint presentation which gives details of the finances of CJP and Sabram. Actually, in the press release, there is one page which gives the information about the funds, that is the donation collected and where the money has been spent.
The sum that is under question is, you know, that is about 3 crores 85 lakhs, right? And so that in that sense, it is about 38 lakhs per year. That is what they are saying is the money that Teesta and Javed have taken from the money that has come to the trust and taken it for their personal purposes. So we thought we'll also present, I mean, they've shared this with us and they've shared this with the various courts and we are sharing this with you, the data of how this amount has been used or what is the breakup for this. So of the total 100%, about 60% is not contested. There is about 40% that is contested. To be noted is that both these trusts are housed in Sabram Communications, which is another company, and office expenses of both these trusts, which is inclusive of the structural use of the space as well as the staff, that comprises almost 40% of what is contested. And so that is not really what is going to Teesta and Javed. The second big chunk is of cash withdrawn, and as Sandhya just said, most expenses are done using cash, and so this is an indicator about 11% of the total trust budget has been going into cash transactions, which are also being claimed that these are also going into Teesta and Javed's pockets.
The office expenses includes everything. That means all the equipment in the office, the rent of the office, the social workers who work there, the people who put up the websites, all the expenses covered for the entire period of 10 years.
10% of this amount, which is 5% of the total amount, is what Teesta has got as honorarium or salary over 10 years. So 5% of 9 crores, the details are there in your sheet, you can look at it. It's not a very large sum for the amount of work that people are doing. The next chunk is the honorarium that Javed has been drawing from both these trusts. And then this is what is, we put it in a pie chart to see what is the sum that we're looking at. Over 10 years, remember this is, and these are the reimbursement for credit card payments. One chunk for Teesta, and as again mentioned earlier, this is for ticket bookings that have been done or for hotel bookings that have been done in the various travels across the country and maybe across the world as well. And then similarly, there is a small little chunk for credit card disbursements of Javed. And their daughter worked for a year in the Sabram Trust, and honorarium that she got, that has also been thrown up as money that they have taken. So I think that this is the breakup of the contested amount, which is 40% of the total sum that has come to both the trusts. So in that, as we have shown you in the sheet that you have, only item numbers 3 and 4 are actually the items that are salaries and honorariums that Javed and Teesta have taken. The rest are all around expenses that the trusts have taken. And just to give you a brief, just to leave this image with you, to show how much what goes into what. That's the kind of breakup of the total sum. And I really urge you to look at the sums per month. And they really, really become tiny and they become totally understandable. That if in a month somebody takes an honorarium of 35,000 rupees, it's not too much. If you look at a figure like some lakhs, it looks a large sum. But when we break it down to 10 years and then look at it per month, then they are small sums. So just look at the table carefully that you have.
There is one small bit to project the malafide intention of Ahmedabad police at the behest of the state and central government. There is a defamation case which was filed by Rais Khan against Teesta. Now the job of the police in a defamation case is only to ensure whether Teesta did utter the defamatory words or not. Whether they are defamatory, whether they are true, that has to be decided by the judge. The police only has to confirm from Teesta whether there was an utterance of this kind. But police do not stop there. Even in that matter, police have asked for accounts of CJP and Sabram Trust for no reason at all. That shows a clear malafide intention of the police. They do not leave any opportunity to hound and harass people who are crusaders for justice, people who strengthen our democracy, and people behind whom we all must stand together. Now, I think Anand will give more details as to the work.
You might find all these facts and figures a little confusing, but once you look at it on the press release, that would make more sense to you. But more than that, what I wanted to do just now is to talk a little bit about the Gujarat state and the Gujarat police and the Gujarat justice system. What has it done so far? So we all know what it did from 2002 when the massacre took place in Gujarat. How many people who were accused of the massacre actually went to jail, and for how long, and what was the role of the Gujarat state in all that matter? In fact, when you look at it, it's the work of the Citizens for Justice and Peace, the group started by Teesta and Javed, that has actually, if people have gone to jail in Gujarat, it's because of this group and people like them in Gujarat who have been tirelessly working to ensure that the guilty of the Gujarat massacre would not go unpunished. It's not only the Gujarat massacre perpetrators that have gone unpunished, but since that 2002 period, there have been a series of encounter killings in Gujarat. A series of encounter killings, the rationale for each one, when I say series, I'm talking about within a short period of a year or two, there were more than 7 or 8 encounter cases with more than 20 people killed in all these cases. People like Ishrat Jahan, Sorabuddin, Tulsi Prajapati, all these people were killed. The police personnel that were involved, finally, the Supreme Court has also ruled that there is no doubt that false encounters took place. People were sent to jail, people like Vanzara, people like PC Pandey. So many people have gone to jail, but since the Modi election, since Modi became Prime Minister, one by one, everybody who was put in jail are coming out. They've been given bail, some of them have been reinstated, some of them have been promoted. So this is the background in which we have to see what is happening today to the few activists who have stood up for justice in Gujarat. I'll just read out to you a list of the work that was done by the Citizens for Justice and Peace. in the, you know that there was a Best Bakery case which the Gujarat government did not find people guilty, and then finally the Supreme Court ordered that this case be moved from Gujarat to Bombay. And in the Best Bakery retrial in Mumbai Sessions case number 315 of 2004, the incident was that 14 people were killed when a mob set fire to the Best Bakery on 1-3-2002. In this case, thanks to the work of CJP, 9 people were convicted and 8 were acquitted. Then we come to the Sardarpura Sessions case number 275 of 2002. Here, this involved 33 people burnt to death in Sardarpura village in Mehsana. 31 people were convicted, 43 acquitted. Then we come to the village of Aud. 23 people, including 9 women and as many children, were burnt alive by a riotous mob at Aud village in Anand district in central Gujarat on March 1, 2002. And one person was killed the next day. In this matter, thanks to the work of the CJP, 23 people were convicted, 23 people were acquitted. The second out case was where 3 people of minority community were killed in Malwa Bhagol area of Aud village on March 1, 2002. Here, 9 people were killed, 9 people were convicted, 32 people acquitted. Then we come to Dibda Darwaza, Viznagar, Mehsana, Sessions case number 180 of 2008. Here, 11 persons from a family that were burnt alive by a mob led by the then BJP MLA of Viznagar, Prahlad Gosa. SIT did not implicate, but response to witnesses caught arraigned MLA and ex-municipal president Dayabhai Patel. 22 people convicted, 61 acquitted. Then the Naroda Patia case. In the worst massacre, could we have the phone on silent, please? In the worst massacre incident of 2002, 97 persons, including many women, were killed. The mobs were led by the then BJP MLA Maya Kodnani and Bajrang Dal leader Babu Bajrangi. Kodnani was charged by SIT in 2010 only after the CJP complained to SC, to the Supreme Court, that powerful beings were being spared. She was arrested and had to resign as a minister. Again, the sad news is that since the Modi government came to power, Maya Kodnani has also been set on bail, has been released on bail despite facing murder charges, despite being convicted of murder. Babu Bajrangi also keeps getting out on bail.
Yes, yes.
Now this is gone. Okay. Yeah. So again, thanks to the CJP, 32 people in the Naroda Patia case were convicted, 29 acquitted. Then the Naroda Gam Sessions case, number 2003 of 2009, 11 people were killed on February 28, 2002. The trial is ongoing. The Gulberg trial sessions, case number 152 of 2002, 69 people were killed on February 28, including Ehsan Jafri, the former Congress MP. This trial is also ongoing. So you can see that the CJP, the Citizens for Justice and Peace, has been a thorn in the flesh of those who perpetrated murder in Gujarat. And there is no doubt in my mind that the reason that Teesta and Javed are being persecuted right now is because of the work they have done to bring the guilty to book. And I think it's our duty as citizens of this country to stand by Teesta and Javed and not allow this witch hunt to continue, and to see that the guilty in Gujarat are punished. Thanks.
You've heard enough so far from other people on the panel about the finances that are involved in this case, and also about the cases of murder and lack of justice that have been happening over the last 12, 15 years in Gujarat. I'd like to place this in a little bit of context, the context that I see this applying to this case. I'd like to draw a parallel to another very well-known case of Dr. Vinayak Sen, who, as you probably know, was convicted to life imprisonment in December 2010 by the Chhattisgarh Sessions Court, but for his connections to Maoists in that area. And I just want to present one small example which for me puts this in context. So in the case of Vinayak Sen, the Chhattisgarh police actually collected a lot of documents from his computer and printed all those out and submitted that to court as evidence to support the prosecution of Dr. Sen. And they are 300 pages, two spiral-bound books of about 300 pages each, so that's the number of documents. And then they each have a table of contents. And so, just to give you this example, one of the entries in this table of contents is, it says, Mahila Kosh. Budget shows 1 crore rupees and its detailing. So you reading it, and in fact, more important than you, the judge reading this this evidence or this these documents is supposed to read it and ask himself, how did a mere pediatrician like Dr. Sen, working in rural Chhattisgarh, get 1 crore rupees? Where did he get all this money from? And in fact, if you go to the document itself in the evidence submitted to the court, that line, the 1 crore rupees, is actually underlined. So what's the answer for this? Well, how did this man get 1 crore rupees? So I asked that question too, and I just went to Google and I typed in, I'm an investigative journalist as it happens, so I typed in, I did my investigation, I typed Mahila Kosh Chhattisgarh into Google, and the first result, and I urge all of you to go and do it too, the first result that you get is the same document in the same fonts, detailing everything that was on Vinayak Sen's computer, that is on the Chhattisgarh government's own website, its own official website. So this Mahila Kosh scheme is actually the government's own scheme, and that 1 crore rupees is the initial corpus that the government of Chhattisgarh has actually given to this Mahila Kosh scheme. It was set up by the government of Chhattisgarh. But in other words, what the government and the police of Chhattisgarh did to Vinayak Sen was to use its own scheme as evidence against Vinayak Sen, purely because Vinayak had probably seen the scheme on the website and said, "Let me save a copy on my computer, and you know, maybe it will be of use at some point." So this was so thin was the evidence against. I mean, this is obvious to anybody who reads the evidence. It seems to me so thin was the evidence against Vinayak Sen that they had to make up charges against him like this. And in effect, that is what they did. They thought they could get away with this, and in effect, that's what they did. They got away with this because they were able to get a judge to convict Sen to life imprisonment. So why am I telling you this, and what is the connection to Teesta and Javed? Just this, it seems to me that in too many cases and with too much so-called evidence, that have happened over the years that I've looked at, they've taught me to be terminally suspicious of this evidence that is presented to court. And This is the same skepticism that I will be applying to this evidence that has been submitted in Teesta and Javed's case. And in fact, it's the skepticism that I believe every citizen of this country must apply. I mean, it's, again, as duties of it's our duty as citizens to apply the skepticism to the evidence that is presented in court. And even more than that, I believe it's actually the greatest, showing the greatest respect to courts to examine this evidence, to examine the cases closely. And I hope that with this press conference and with the events that are going to unfold over the next few days and weeks, that's what we will all be doing, examining the evidence that is submitted in Teesta and Javed's case. Because like in Dr. Sen's case, I believe there is nothing in this evidence. Thank you.
I forgot to say one thing about when I talked about the encounter killings in Gujarat, in which all these police personnel and the state was directly involved and even put in jail. The one thing about the encounter killings is that all these encounter killings were done for one reason alone. The reason that they gave was that all these people were going to kill Narendra Modi. So all these encounter killings was done in order to tell the public that Narendra Modi is so great that people are trying to kill him all the time. And all these encounter killings were found to be fake encounters.
So far you've heard all the legal aspects and things in this case. What really worries me is the morality and the ethics of this kind of a witch hunt. It really is threatening the democratic fabric of our nation. I am from a generation which vividly remembers the emergency. And at least Indira Gandhi had the decency of proclaiming an emergency before she let loose her tyranny. Over here today, we are seeing tyranny being unleashed without even a pretext at making it legal. This is what we should all be worried about, because this sends a signal out to every Indian who is concerned about the democratic health of our nation. It sends out a signal to every Indian who feels that it is his or her right to stand up and question governance and government and politicians, because now they will always think that if they stand up for rights or for ethics or for honesty, they could get into trouble. This was done when Narendra Modi was chief minister in Gujarat. I remember there was a case of a journalist in Surat who was prosecuted for sedition because he wrote some report critical of the chief minister at that time. The case didn't stand up, but the effort, there was a effort to do that kind of arm twisting even then. So this tendency has been over there. What also concerns me is when you heard Anand talking about all the cases that Teesta and Javed's NGO have managed to get into court and get people prosecuted on. If the government of Gujarat and the Gujarat police do arrest Teesta and Javed, how will they ensure that these will not be threatened by the people who only got convicted because of their effort? They had believed that they could get away scot-free with murder because the government was protecting them. If it hadn't been for SJP and Teesta and Javed and their efforts, these people would have gotten away with murder. Now they are in jail because of their effort. And if suppose the Gujarat government arrests Teesta and Javed, will they be able to ensure that they will always be protected from these people that they got convicted and imprisoned? Or is it the plan? There are some more who are there. Some of them have gotten out on bail, but there are a lot more who are in jail over there. And you cannot always I always was told, not only in Hindi films, but the best way to murder somebody is to get a policeman to do it. And how does the system which goes on a witch hunt then ensure that that witch hunt will not be carried out at their behest or by somebody who wants to curry favor from that system itself? Because you will have noticed that so many people who have helped the accused and the administration to get away with their crimes in 2002 have been rewarded. They have been given positions and better prospects. Just yesterday there was a report that an emissary has been sent to Vanjara's brother to ensure that he might get some plum position once he gets out on bail. Yeah. And so how does the Indian democracy ensure that it does not fall prey to these kind of strong-arm tactics? We have to be concerned about that. See, the legalities will work themselves out. The courts, fortunately there are some courts which will still look at the legality and the morality and the ethicality of the cases, and they might be able to prove themselves not guilty. But what in the period while those cases are going on, what, how does one ensure that they are not punished in the way Gujarat police have been become very infamous about? Not only Gujarat police, so many other places also this is becoming this is happening. And this is what I think we should all be worried about, and this is what I think we should all be alert about. The fourth estate will have to stand up. We've seen too much of kowtowing and being obsequious to the powers that be. We have to stand up, otherwise one fine day there will be nobody left to raise their voices. And that is the question that we should all be worried about. That's what worries me the most, because when I told my children today that I'm going to a press conference to defend Teesta, they said, "Dad, be a bit careful." And I hate that my children get worried because I'm just attending a press conference. But I don't have the ability to assure them that their worry is baseless, their worry is futile. Because anything can be engineered, anything can be rigged up today in this age. I just, 2 days back, I tweeted saying I stand with Teesta. The amount of obscene responses that I have got to that one tweet that I made is unbelievable, and it shows the kind of hate campaign that is being run in this nation. They not only abused me, they not only questioned my ethicality and morality, but they went right up to my great-grandfather. It pains me to repeat it, but I'm going to repeat that, because they said ki beta to khade rehne ki baat karta hai, dada to sota tha. To the tweet that I said I stand with Teesta, this was the response that was tweeted and retweeted and retweeted, and it's continuously being retweeted even 3 days later. This is the kind of hate that these people are running unofficially. And that is what we should all be worried about much more than the legal stuff, because I still have a bit of trust left in the justice system, the courts of this land, that not all of them have been compromised as yet. But all these other peripheral questions that may be vital in this case or may cause us to be regretful later on must also be brought out in public and debated, so that the government does not have the notion that they can get away with anything. At the moment they are like the cat that got the milk and the cream and the rat also, and nobody seems to be questioning them. These are the questions that must be raised, that, so that they know that some people will stand up, some people will question. And I think this opportunity gives us a reason to sound the alarm before we slip into the abyss of another official emergency situation. That is what I think we should all be worried about, and that is what I think we should all be talking about loudly, clearly and fearlessly.
Yeah, any questions people have? After I read about what happened in the encounter killings in Gujarat, please go through that, go through the whole file. Mr. Amit Shah himself is implicated in the encounter killings of Tulsi Prajapati and
Sorabuddin.
And even then, the court allowed Mr. Amit Shah not to appear in court at all when he has murder charges. Mr. Modi made him election chief in Uttar Pradesh. He delivered the election, but before that he delivered Muzaffarnagar. And after that, he has delivered election victories in many places. So the point is that there is no rule of law in Gujarat. There is, for us to expect and for us to be relaxed about what happens in the police custody in Gujarat, I think it would be foolish to think that nothing will happen. Maybe nothing will happen, but do we want to take that chance?
It's also worth mentioning Harend Pandya, not even part of the establishment there. The defense is not was killed, and nobody knows yet how that happened.
Should I make a point here? So if the state has got two projects very clear, one is to tarnish the image of Teesta and Javed, the other project is to take them into custody. And India is not a signatory to the International Convention for Prevention of Custodial Torture. So it is not only Gujarat police. All the state polices are notorious, and Gujarat police takes the case. Given the background, the implications could be too disturbing, and it would be irreparable loss if something happens.
It is not an accident that the Supreme Court moved two cases out of Gujarat. They moved them.
Is there a provision that this case can also be moved out of Gujarat?
With the present government, do you think that is likely to happen? The present government will allow.
You know, the thing is that the age of the imprisonment over a period of 10 years, and then they should proceed to the charity commissioner and the tax commissioner, because they have not seen the audited reports for so many years. Why aren't they prosecuting them?
Not only that, surprisingly, police have not inquired with any of the five authorities that we listed. They haven't found out from any of these authorities whether there was anything wrong at all with the accounts. They haven't bothered. So it's a clear, cooked up case.
The issue is whether custodial interrogation is required or not. That's the immediate issue at the moment on the table. Whether custodial interrogation is required or not.
Only till the
19th.
I am asking, what will you do? Because, you know, what will you do in the sense that as a citizen of India, what will you do? Because that's the question we all have to ask ourselves. The point is that as a citizen of India, as somebody in the media, at a time when the media has become an embedded media of the state and the corporates, whether it's the electronic media or the print media, who owns them and what is their position politically? You can see that every day. If you read the news, I read the news, we watch TV. So if that
is... I think the only way for the citizens is to launch an application against this, at least those people who are concerned about the Indian democracy. At one point of time, how much pushing could we take? That is the question. How much will we allow them to push us? And when we say no more. And that will have, that question will have to be answered very soon.
Another important point that you should be kept in mind is that participatory bid should be rejected only when there is non-cooperation and if there is a requirement for custodial interrogation. That is the first thing. Then the prima facie case is laid out. We have shown you that the prima facie case is obviously suspect. But the second part, which is an important thing, is that they have been cooperating with the police, and that is what is not being highlighted in the media. Is that they have been cooperating with the police, they have supplied all these documents to the police, they have gone to the police, they have had meetings where they have given all these documents and they have to be examined. And here today we have Gujarat High Court, which has not even examined these documents. This is not a case where anticipatory bail must be rejected. In fact, this is the kind of, it's a classic case for grant of anticipatory bail. So other than the apprehensions also going purely by the merits of the case, this is a case for grant of anticipatory bail, then why have we gone through this entire process in denying justice to two defenders of justice? And this obviously puts a big question mark on what the intent of the Gujarat police is.
Sir, Hindi mein do question.
Hindi mein brief kar sakein pura vishay to.
कौन सा भाग आपको समझ में नहीं आया?
समझ में आया, लेकिन हिंदी के लिए शॉर्ट में ब्रीफ कर देना,
शॉर्ट में हिंदी में बताना।
बहुत संक्षेप में कहूंगा कि हम लोग यहाँ पे आए हैं प्रेस कॉन्फ्रेंस लेने के लिए कि हमने अपनी तरफ से जांच की है और हमने अकाउंट्स देखे हैं, जो आर्ग्यूमेंट्स है उसको देखे हैं, और हमें ये साफ महसूस हो रहा है कि ये केस, इस केस में कोई दम नहीं है, अकाउंट्स में कोई हेराफेरी हुई नहीं है। इस तीस्ता और जावेद को जो तंग किया जा रहा है वो एक ही कारण से हो रहा है, और वो कारण है कि 2002 के बाद, कांड के बाद, जो आरोपी जिन्होंने कांड किया था उनको सज़ा नहीं मिल रही थी, मगर तीस्ता और जावेद की संस्था सिटीजन्स फॉर जस्टिस एंड पीस, इसकी, इनकी वजह से काफ़ी लोग जेल में चले गए, काफ़ी केसेस हुए वहाँ गुजरात में भी और बम्बई में भी, जैसे बेस्ट बेकरी केस हुई और सज़ा हुई लोगों को। तो यानि जो गुजरात में सज़ा नहीं हो रही थी इनके कारण सज़ा होने लगी, और ये नाराज़गी सबसे ज़्यादा गुजरात पुलिस की ये नाराज़गी है और गुजरात स्टेट की ये नाराज़गी है और शायद भारत सरकार की भी ये नाराज़गी है कि जो जिन्होंने हत्याकांड किया उनको सज़ा होने लगी है। वो नहीं चाहते हैं कि उनके जो मित्र मंडली हैं जिन्होंने हत्याकांड किया है वो जेल जाए, और इसीलिए ये बदले की भावना से हो रहा है।
कौन करवा रहा है, क्या लगता है
कौन, और कौन करवा रहा होगा?
और एक बात, ये जो केस है गुलबर्ग सोसाइटी का केस, जहां पे 69 लोगों को जिंदा मार के जलाया गया था, जिसमें एहसान जाफरी कांग्रेस के एक्स एमपी भी थे, उनकी वाइफ ने ये प्राइवेट कंप्लेंट किया कि मोदी और बीजेपी के अदर डिग्निटरीज उनके खिलाफ एफआईआर रजिस्टर किया जाए। ये एक ही केस गुजरात में ऐसी है जिसमें मिस्टर मोदी के खिलाफ एफआईआर करने की दर्ज की है, और ये केस जब कोर्ट में आया है तभी से ये गुलबर्ग सोसाइटी का मामला मोदी के लिए बहुत गर्म हो गया है, और यही वजह है कि यही गुलबर्ग सोसाइटी का को सामने करके इस तरह से तीस्ता और जावेद के खिलाफ ये कोशिश चालू है।
आपकी आशंका सही हो सकती है, आपकी आशंका सही हो सकती है, लेकिन क्या तीस्ता को, जावेद को इस तरह से जो पैसे आए हैं ट्रस्ट में म्यूजियम के नाम पे वो खर्च करने का अधिकार है, और जो उन्होंने रिइंबर्समेंट दिखाया क्रेडिट कार्ड से, वो क्या सही है, आप सही मानते हो?
आपने सही सुना नहीं है, हमने बताया कि जो
मैंने पूरा पढ़ लिया है, पूरा सुन लिया है,
जो पैसा इकट्ठा किया था वो 4.6 लाख है, और वो अभी भी बैंक अकाउंट में वैसे के वैसा है। इसके बावजूद कि जो लोगों ने ये डोनेशन दिया था उन्होंने ये बोला सीजेपी को कि ये पैसा अगर हम म्यूजियम नहीं बना सकते हैं तो आप बाकी के केस जहां आप कोर्ट में संघर्ष कर रहे हैं वहां उसको इस्तेमाल कीजिए। उसके बावजूद ये पैसा अभी भी वैसे ही रखा है, उसको हाथ नहीं लगाया।
यानी म्यूजियम के लिए सिर्फ 4 लाख समथिंग जो है
4.6
जी हाँ पढ़ लीजिए आप
दीपक
देखिए जो जो कहा जा रहा है कि उन्होंने घोटाला किया और जो म्यूजियम का पैसा है उसमें से उन्होंने अपने निजी खर्च के लिए इस्तेमाल कर दिया है ये सही नहीं है। 4 लाख कुछ रुपए जो आए पैसे म्यूजियम बनाने के लिए वो वैसे के वैसे पड़े हुए हैं और जबकि जिन लोगों ने वो पैसे दिए थे उन्होंने जब ये उनको ये बताया गया कि भाई इस पैसे में से हम म्यूजियम नहीं बना पाएंगे तो उन्होंने उनको ये कहा कि आप उसको आपके जो आप जो लड़ाई लड़ रही है जस्टिस के लिए उसके लिए खर्चा कर सकती है, तब भी वो पैसा बैंक में ऐसे का ऐसा रखा गया है। पर आप अगर न्यूज़ पढ़ेंगे तो सब जगह पे ये कहा जा रहा है कि बेचारे जो विक्टिम्स थे उनके लिए जो पैसे आए उसमें से तीसरा और जावेद ने अपनी अय्याशियों के लिए खर्चा किया है, तो अय्याशिया कौन कर रहा है और किसके बलबूते पे कर रहा है वो तो बहुत जाहिर है। महंगे महंगे कपड़े महंगी महंगी दावतें कौन दे रहा है वो तो सब देख रहे हैं। तीसरा और जावेद के बदन पे मैंने कोई ऐसी कीमती चीज देखी नहीं जिससे मुझे ये शक हो कि भाई ये पैसा कहाँ से आया, जबकि तीस्ता एक बंगले में ऐसे रहती है पुश्तैनी बंगले में जिसकी आज बाजार में कीमत कई 100 करोड़ हो सकती है। तो ये कितना भद्दा आरोप है और कितना बेबुनियाद आरोप है वो ये सारी चीजों पे से पता चलता है और किस मकसद से ये किया जा रहा है। सिर्फ मुझे नहीं लगता कि ये सिर्फ तीस्ता और जावेद को शांत करने की साजिश है, ये एक एक सिग्नल भेजा जा रहा है कि भाई तुम लोग लाइन में रहो, तुम लोग शांत रहो, चुपचाप रहो, वरना आज जो नौबत इन पे ऊपर आई है वो तुम्हारे ऊपर भी आने में हम झिझकेंगे नहीं। और ये बात है जो हमको जिसके खिलाफ हमको चौकन्ना रहना पड़ेगा। बापू ने कहा था कि अगर सरकार लोक विरोधी हो जाए तो हर नागरिक का धर्म होगा बगावत। मुझे लगता है कि हम उस कगार तक पहुंच रहे हैं जब हर हिंदुस्तानी नागरिक का धर्म बनेगा बगावत, क्योंकि हमारा हिंदुस्तान जिस तरह से हमने हमारे फाउंडिंग फादर्स ने उसको बनाया था उसको महफूज रखने के लिए हमको शायद बगावत भी करनी पड़े।
उसने
उसने
वो
पहले वाले
उसने लिखा है कि उन्होंने 2008 में नौकरी से निकाला क्योंकि उन्होंने किसी से बदतमीजी की, गुलबर्ग सोसाइटी की जो सर्वाइवर्स है उनके साथ बदतमीजी से पेश आए इसके लिए उनको निकाला गया। तभी से वो पुलिस के साथ जुड़कर जहाँ जहाँ काम जहाँ जहाँ लोगों का न्याय के लिए संघर्ष चल रहा है वहाँ कोर्ट में जाके लोगों के खिलाफ बात करता है। ये आपका
बताया तो बोला था कि ये बंदे के लिए ये बदला भी पीड़ित है
वो बेस्ट बेकरी कांड के टाइम पे भी वो ऐसे एलिगेशंस
मतलब वो अलग
थे लेकिन
कैसे हो गया वो बता रहे
बताया तो सही कि उसने बदतमीजी की
किसी के साथ नौकरी से निकाल दिया। अब क्या किसी को नौकरी पर अब क्या किसी को नौकरी पर
देखिए मानना ना मानना आपकी बात है, बहस नहीं कर
सकते। हम राजस्थान के खिलाफ बात नहीं कर रहे, हम गुजरात पुलिस किसके खिलाफ बात कर रही है, समझ के रखा। एक इंसान के ऊपर
बेस्ट बेकरी के टाइम में भी एलिगेशन जो किए गए थे तब भी ये कहा गया था कि कंप्लेनेंट उसका ही आदमी है, और वो भी पता चल गया था कि किस तरह से वो मैनिपुलेट किया गया था। ये नई बात नहीं है, ये नई बात नहीं है। हाँ, अगर आप ये मान के चलते हो कि जो ऑफिशियल वर्जन है वो सही है, तो फिर वो गलतफहमी दूर हो ही नहीं सकती कभी। इसलिए या तो न्यूट्रलिटी में रहे या ये माने कि शक की बुनियाद है।
ये भी मामला पड़ेगा कि ये जो पैसे की मामला है वो रईस खान उसमें तो शामिल नहीं है, ये कोई गुलबर्ग सोसाइटी के कोई और मेंबर थे जो
अज्ञात व्यक्ति हो।
लेटर हेड लेके यहाँ पे लिखा हुआ है कि फॉर्जरी करके, और वो कंप्लेंट उस लेटर हेड पे दिया गया है,
जाली लेटर हेड पे शिकायत लिख के दी गई है जिसका कोई वजूद नहीं।
इस केस में हम जो हम इसके बारे में बात कर रहे हैं, राजस्थान में कोई
I don't think
anybody is against the probe. Why should we put the probe has been going on and none of us have actually spoken out saying that probe should not go on.
It's not necessary.
As somebody in the audience said, the issue right now is there a necessity for custodial interrogation?
See, there is a parallel case ke jahan jiske upar khoon ka ilzam hai usko court mein aane se chutti di jati hai baar baar. Ye to ek sirf financial irregularity kathit स्वरूप में, उसमें आपको उस व्यक्ति को जेल में डालने की क्या जरूरत है जब खून के मामले में आप उनको छुट्टियां दिया जा रहे हो, तो इसमें क्या जरूरत है?
नहीं, उसमें वो गिरफ्तार हुए थे फिर जमानत पे गिरफ्तार हो चुके थे।
ऑल्सो दिस वन पॉइंट सेक्शंस अगेंस्ट हर आर मैक्सिमम पनिशेबल विद 7 इयर्स and Supreme Court has repeatedly said up to 7 years if the person is cooperating you should grant her anticipatory bail. 1.5 years everything has been submitted, they have repeatedly appeared before the police station, so there is no need for custodial interrogation. That's what they are saying, and conditions can be put that you can go and visit the police station again and again. That is what has happened. Regarding the Amit Shah case, where the parallels of justice can be drawn, this thing where they are saying that we stand for justice and justice should be done where the victim's money has been taken away. In Amit Shah's case, there are 3 encounters. He has been discharged by court, rightly, wrongly, we don't know. CBI didn't oppose it, and today CBI says we will not challenge it before the High Court. This shows what justice they want. Whether it is wrong, right judgment, but at least challenge it. You do it in all cases. Why only Amit Shah has been singled out? Why is it that not being challenged by CBI? And who rules the CBI? We know.
Now he is discharged, but even when he was charged, he was allowed not to come to court. Forget about police custody. He doesn't have to appear in court when his own matter is going on. And he got murder charge. Have you ever heard of somebody charged with murder who is allowed to do anything he likes but doesn't have to come to court?
Thank you, sir. Thank you. So, I just want to clarify. If the donation total receipts on loan, 9.75 crore during a period of 10 years, average per annum 1 crore aata hai. So, 1 crore mein wo paisa alag alag head ke andar jayega. Donation, dusra koi, aur koi kisi ke liye reimbursement koi diya hoga, ye sab usme jayega. So, ultimately, donation kitna aata hai? Total 10 mahine ka, 10 saal ka donation 4 lakh ho gaya. तो ये विश्लेषण कौन करेगा? पुलिस कर सकती है, ये विश्लेषण खाली सीए करेगा। इसमें डोनेशन कितना है, दूसरा एक्सपेंडिचर के दूसरा रिसीप्ट कितना है, ये फलाना फलाना रिसीप्ट कितना है, फलाना फलाना एक्सपेंडिचर कितना है, ये खाली सीए कर सकता है। ये रिपोर्ट्स जो आ रहे हैं मीडिया में, ये गलत रिपोर्ट्स आ रहे हैं। वो टोटल ट्रांजेक्शन समरी दे रहा है 10 साल का टोटल, और कह रहे हैं कि ये इतना डोनेशन है, वो गलत है।
डोनेशन दो ट्रस्ट है उनके लिए डोनेशन अलग अलग चीजों के लिए आते हैं ये सारे के सारे वही दिखा रहे हैं कि गुलबर्ग सोसाइटी मेमोरियल के लिए आए जो बिल्कुल गलत है उनके लिए जो आए वो 4.5 लाख से कम है कोई गलती उसमें नहीं मिली
होगी
तो आजकल हम लोग टैक्स भरते हैं वो पुलिस के पास भेजते हैं
Neither charity commissioner nor income tax nor home ministry to find out why they have not objected. Only police find something wrong with
the accounts. Nobody else does. And none of the funders have raised any problems with their home ministry. That is a very important thing. None of the funders have raised any problems.
You must also remember one thing. This government has used the financial tool to harass every voice of objection raised against government policies. You look at NGOs, you look at Greenpeace, you look at all of them. All of them, the attempt has been made to silence them by projecting financial irregularities in their processes and systems. So there are precedents why doubts are raised in everybody's minds as to this being a similar kind of a witch hunt and the government finding a convenient method to harass people who they are not comfortable with. Everywhere, everyone who is not amicable to them.
And whoever has granted bail in this encounter matters are now all being reinstated.
Yes.
With three encounters on their heads.
They are in charge of the people who gave testimony against them. They have been proclaimed so that they can be on top of the people who testified against them.
In terms of that question about financial irregularity, there is an item in today's Economic Times about the chairman who has also been charged with financial irregularity, but he is now no longer a supporter of
Thank you.
सुनो भाई कोई भी है लेकिन मैं के अंदर एक बार भाई देख यार भाई लोग
केबल मोटी रहा है
ये देखो ये ना भगवान है चेन्नई भाई देख भाई हो गया।